In this video, we're going to talk about how data is stored in memory. In particular, we'll talk about how numbers are stored in the bytes of memory, and we'll talk about Big Endian and Little Endian byte ordering. Let's begin by reviewing the different sizes of data. We've talked about bytes. Each byte has 8 bits. We've talked about half words, which have 2 bytes or 16 bits. Words are 32 bits or 4 bytes. Double words are 8 bytes, 64 bits. And finally, quad words are 16 bytes or 128 bits. So here I have shown with each rectangle 1 byte, and the bits within the byte can be referred to as from the least significant all the way to the most significant. So we have 7 bits in a byte. The least significant byte is bit 0. The least significant bit in this byte is numbered 0, and the most significant bit in this byte is numbered 7. With a half word, we number our bits from 0 to 15, because there are 16 bits total. The bits in a word are numbered from 0 to 31, and again, there are 4 bytes in a word. And finally, the double word has 64 bits, and the quad word has 128 bits. In all cases, the least significant bit is 0, and the most significant bit is a number less than, 1 less than the number of bits in the entire quantity. So now let's store a word into 4 bytes in memory. Here is a depiction of memory. Every byte has an address. So this byte is addressed 100, 101, 102, 103, 104, 105, and so on. Each byte of memory has an address, and the addresses are shown above these boxes, and each box is big enough to hold 8 bits. So there are 2 different ways the data is stored into memory. The first we'll talk about is Big Endian, and this makes the most sense. So let's look at a 32-bit integer value where the first byte is 0, 1, and then 2, 3, and then 4, 5, and then 6, 7. So this is a 32-bit number, and we could spell out the actual bits of this number if we wanted to. 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, and then 2, and then 3, and then 4, and then 5, and then 6, and then 7. So this is the least significant bit, bit number 0 here, and over here we have bit number 31. Okay? Divided into 4 bytes. Now, each one of these 4 bytes is going to go into memory, and we're going to store them in the logical order in Big Endian. We're going to put the first byte here. Let's say we want to store the data starting at location 102. So we'd put the first byte at 102, the second byte at 103, the third byte at 104, and the last byte at 105. This is Big Endian. This is the way that makes total sense. And it's pretty straightforward. The most significant byte is first, and they go in order. Here I've shown memory reading left to right, and we can start with the lowest memory locations to the left and the higher memory locations to the right. And there's a second way to store things in memory, and that's in the reverse. It's backwards from Big Endian, and it's called Little Endian. And Little Endian stores these bytes in the reverse order, okay, in a backwards order. So if you were to look at memory, you'd see the byte 6, 7 first. In other words, you'd see the least significant byte stored in the lowest address. So if we try to store the same 32-bit integer value in the same location, but we store it in Little Endian order, it would go into memory like this. The contents of memory would be different. So we can store a 32-bit integer value either in big endian order in memory or in little endian order in memory. Most processors use big endian order, and big endian seems to make the most logical sense. Little endian is backwards from the way people think and is used by the Intel processors and leads to various kinds of confusion. So be very careful with little endian because things are in a different order than they are in big endian. Here's another view of memory. And in this diagram, each rectangle represents one byte of memory. And I have drawn the byte with the lowest address at the top of the picture and the byte with the largest address at the bottom of the picture. So each rectangle is a byte, so we could number the bits from 0 to 7, least significant to most significant. And we refer to this as low memory and this as high memory. If the computer uses 32 bits for addresses, as many of them do, then we have up to 4 gigabytes of memory. Okay, all the way from 0 to, in hex, the largest unsigned hex number is 2 to the 32, or FFFFFFFF in hex. Each word takes 4 bytes, so if we're storing a 32-bit integer into memory, we need 4 bytes. And so I've shown where we might put a word at address 4. The address of any data is always the address of the lowest byte, the first byte. Now, I should also point out that this is just one way to draw memory, and there's not really a standard. The other way is to turn it upside down and draw the lowest addresses at the bottom and the highest addresses up at the top of the diagram. Like this. You could say that this makes more sense because low memory is low and high memory is high. But the way it's actually stored in the computer, well, in the computer there's no organization, no vertical organization. They're laid out on circuit boards and it's spread around chips and so on. So this is just the way we can think of things. And so this representation is also quite common. It's important to be clear which way you're talking about it. The next thing I want to do is I want to store a 32-bit value into memory, and I want to store it first in big endian order. So, for example, the Spark or the architecture or the PowerPC or the ARM architecture would store it in big endian order. So here we have the 4 bytes of the word from least significant to most significant. And in big endian order, the most significant byte goes in the lowest numbered addressed byte. So the byte with the lowest address is 4 here. We're storing it at address 4. So we put this byte at address 4, and the least significant byte goes at address 7. Okay. The most significant byte is first. The least significant byte is last. This is the way a big endian computer would store a 32-bit number. Next, let's look at a little endian architecture like the Intel processors. And again, we're storing a 32-bit value into memory at address 4. But this time, the least significant byte is going into the lowest numbered byte. So it's storing it in reverse order. The little endian architectures store the number in reverse order. The bytes are in the opposite order from big endian. The byte at the lowest address is the least significant byte, and the byte at the highest address at 7 is the most significant byte. Now, it looks like I have crossed, these arrows are all crossed, with the way I've drawn it here. But keep in mind, that's just an artifact of the way I've drawn it. If I had drawn it the other way, like this, the arrows would be not crossed for least significant, for Little Indian. So this is Little Indian. And so it's just an artifact of whether I put the boxes down here or up higher. And it's also an artifact of how I drew my memory. If I were to draw lower addresses at the bottom of the page and higher addresses at the top of the page, like this, and then I'm storing this number here, Little Indian goes in, again, this way without the arrows crossing each other, whereas Big Indian would have the arrows crossing. So whether the arrows cross or not is not significant with this. In the rest of this video, I'm going to talk about C and go over a program that shows byte ordering. If you're not interested in the C programming language, you can skip the rest of this video. But I want to take a look at this program, and I want to show its output when it's run on a Big Indian computer. And then in the next slide, I'll show its output when it's run on a computer in Little Indian. So here we have a standard C program. We've got a main routine. We are going to be doing some printing. So we have an include for the standard library for the IO, studio.h. And we're also going to be using size of, so we have to include string.h. here. Our main program calls a subroutine, which is named show bytes. Here's our subroutine show bytes. It's passed two parameters. One is a pointer called start, and the other is a length. The length is just an integer. Start is a pointer to bytes, and we represent bytes as unsigned characters. So it's an unsigned character pointer. So what is it going to do? Well, it's passed a length, and it's going to loop length times. So, for example, if length is 4, it's going to execute this print statement 4 times. And what is this print statement going to do? Start is a pointer to bytes, and we're going to use the index value I, which ranges from 0 to, in this example, 3, and we're going to print out the bytes in order. This notation here in C is a formatting thing. Since it starts with percent and ends with X, it means print out this thing in hexadecimal using two digits or two hex digits, and then print a new line afterwards. So if we call this with a pointer and the number 4, it will print out 4 bytes like it does in the first line here. So in our main routine, we've got some variables defined, and we call show bytes 4 times, and it prints out these 4 lines. The first variable is an integer, so it's a signed quantity. It's 4 bytes long, and we set it equal, and we give it a value in hexadecimal. And this, the first call to show bytes is passed a pointer to I, and the size of I is 4, so it prints out 4 bytes. And it prints them out in the order you expect. This is a Big Indian architecture, so it prints out 01, 02, 03, 04. Now, when we run this thing on the Little Indian architecture, this is the same program, I've only changed the output here, and when we run this program, it prints out the same number, but it prints them out in reverse order. So the least significant byte, 04, 03, 02, 01. The next statement is to print out a floating point number. Okay, and in this case, we haven't talked about how floating point numbers are represented yet. It's rather complex, but it turns out this thing is represented with 4 bytes, and this thing prints out those bytes as 42F6E979. When we run it on the Little Indian architecture, it prints out the same thing, but in the reverse order. 42F6E979. 42F6E979. Same numbers, reverse order. The next thing we print out is a pointer, okay? IP is a pointer, okay? So it's a pointer to integers, and we are setting IP to point to the address of I. Here's I. Where's I stored? Well, it's stored someplace in memory, and we're making IP be the address of that. On this architecture, the size of pointers is 4 bytes. So it prints out some number here, okay? On the Intel architecture, the way this is compiled, pointers are 8 bytes. Okay, so it prints out 8 bytes in this case. And the number it prints out has absolutely no relationship to this number here. For example, FFBF. Well, you see FF. But you don't see the other stuff there. So these are two very different numbers. And lastly, we have a string. And S points to the 6 letters in memory, A, B, C, D, E, F. They're stored in ASCII, and those values are 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, and 46. Now, characters are stored in the order that they're given on both Little Indian and Big Indian architectures, so there's no difference there. So both programs print out the same exact line, 6 bytes starting with 41, 6 bytes starting with 41. So this program shows how data is represented, and it's different on different machines. And these differences can come back to bite you if you're trying to write C code that runs identically on different computers. Then you have to be aware of some of these very subtle things, like how data is represented. Most programs don't make use of the fact that the integers are stored in Big Indian or Little Indian form. But with programming language C, you have a lot of flexibility in going in to look at memory, so you can actually get different results. Here we have the same exact program, and when run on two different machines, it produces two different outputs because it's implemented differently. The C language has a lot of implementation dependencies. So the way the C programming language is implemented on one computer can vary a little bit from the way it's implemented on another computer. And in some programs, those differences can cause differences in output. And ideally, you'd like to write programs that produce the exact same output, regardless of what platform they're run on. So you need to be aware of some of these subtleties here.